Hanif, I'm very excited to have the chance to actually speak with you, although I feel like we've been having metaphysical conversations with each other across space and time, whether we knew it or not, which is also a theme, I think, one of the many themes in your extraordinary new book.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. I love liner notes of the revolution, but it's also interesting because the first way I came to your work was liner notes, I believe, for Tammy Terrell, maybe. I remember feeling such a large affection for that because I'm a big Tammy Terrell fan. And I often feel like she doesn't get her due as an artist independent of like men, you know, which is, of course, is like that just happens to Black women and particularly soul singers who just get lensed through what other men do or do not do. So it was great to think on that and then arrive at this book, which was wonderful.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And as we continue the mutual praise party, you know, your season of Lost Notes is something that's very close to my heart. And I am, you know, Bay Area through and through, but I also spent formative years in my 20s in graduate school in Los Angeles and have listened to KCRW ever since. And so being able to really, especially during this pandemic season, have them excerpt these moments in Lost Notes as we eased into Morning Becomes Eclectic, then with Ann Litt, now with Anthony Valdez and the great Naveena Carmel, just being able to hear you meditate on Grace Jones and Minnie Riperton, you know, at the top of the hour, it was the way to bring some light into darkness. So thank you for that. That was a mammoth, gorgeous endeavor.
Thank you. I feel like now I'm becoming a collector of small things that are small obsessions. And I've begun to kind of collect Black magazines from the 60s and 70s and sometimes early 80s. And it's so interesting. I got an Ebony from 1979, maybe. And Grace Jones is on the cover. And it's so interesting to see how Grace Jones was perceived in the air. I'm looking at her now. When I finished Lost Notes, they sent me this beautiful photo for the one of her playing the accordion. But it's so fascinating to look back and have these texts and see how in magazines Grace Jones was perceived. It's just, it's fascinating.
Yeah, I just did the podcast Who Cares About the Rock Hall. This was before this year's historic nominations. But my episode was about making a case for Grace Jones, which, should we have to make a case? That's also, I think, a theme in your book.
Yeah, and that's the thing too, though. To be fair, I'm someone who, you know, rails against the Rock Hall pretty robustly. And I mean, just like with all, I'm an Ohioan, so like all love to Cleveland, but if they, you know, bulldoze that thing, I wouldn't mind. But like, since I don't foresee it being abolished in my lifetime, then I have questions about like, should there even have to be an argument for Fela Kuti to be in the Rock Hall of Fame?
Yes.
You know what I mean? Yes. Like if Fela Kuti were with his resume catalog, I think even if he were a Black American artist, he would have long been in.
Oh, you know? Completely.
But because possibly. There's no.
Possibly.
Yeah.
I mean, possibly, right? I mean, right? But yes, much more of a chance.
Much more of a chance. I think people just don't think about the global. Global political climate in which he was creating in, because Americans are so America-centric. Yes. But Grace Jones, there should not need to be a case. I think I'm often asking what's valued when we talk about when the Rock Hall is being weighed and measured. Because if it's, is it body of work? Is it influence? Is it longevity? Like
it's all of those things and none of those things, depending on which kinds of artists we're talking about, right? Oh, my head's exploding. I want to go in so many different directions. I want to talk about, especially, you know, given the platform that we have within the context of Rolling Stone magazine culture, which I grew up obsessed with, and I talk about a little bit in the book, but the extent to which making cases, you know, is so much a part of both the ethos and the style, you know, even kind of the argumentative structure of rock criticism as we've come to know it through the golden age and handed down from gonzo journalism, and what that means for Black writers to enter into that space of making cases, of either inhabiting the role of making cases or assuming the role of being the defendant, you know, so to speak. And that's, of course, very charged language, especially as we continue to think about Minneapolis, but I would love to talk with you about that. I love the fact that, you know, even in referencing the fact that you have an Ebony magazines from the late 70s, which is my era. Okay. So we've got Black Gen Xer and millennial. I'm technically a millennial.
Yeah.
But I'm excited about and fascinated by the long cultural memories that, you know, we cultivate and curate, you know, broadly as Black folks, but also as critics. And I'm curious about your trajectory. I mean, I write about it a little bit in the book, and I've talked about my being, I was a menopause baby, as I like to call it. My parents didn't expect me. And I had these much older siblings who were unusually spread apart anyways. They were 17 years older than me and 10 years older than me. But I got that long kind of cultural memory from them and from my great migration parents. And so it was just this admixture of, you know, wild elixir of all these different sounds in our house. But when I started listening to The Police and The Clash and even Prince, you know, I had to go outside the house to you know, continue to curate my world. So I'm curious about how you, a millennial, you know, how you think about what it means to have a Grace Jones Ebony magazine cover and everything that goes into this long history in this book that you've written.
Yeah, I was lucky in that I'm the youngest of four, and I had two siblings that were... Yeah, right. I had two siblings that were much older, and I had parents who loved music. And it was also in the 90s. Like, I came up in the 90s. And so in my older siblings and the Black neighborhood I grew up in, I mean, I write about this a bit in the book, everyone was kind of exploring sounds. It wasn't just like, so yes, you know, hip hop was probably the first music I connected to, but my older siblings were also listening to punk and metal and like funk, you know. I'm from Ohio, so like funk was present always, and my parents were listening to jazz and soul. So I had a really wide toolbox for sounds that I could gravitate towards when I began to listen on my own. And when I had my own money, you know, especially when I got my own little bit of money to buy my own albums and to kind of wander record stores, that is something I feel gratitude for, that I grew up around like Black punks, and that the people handing me the records were like other Black kids or my older siblings or whatever. Like, you know, the first time I heard Nirvana, a Black girl on the bus gave me Nevermind, you know? And so that was my upbringing, you know, that's how I came up. And so I never equated, you know, it's so funny, and not saying that this is not someone else's lived experience, but whenever I see Black folks like, oh, I got made fun of because I listened to Weezer or whatever, that's always so odd. That's always so foreign to me, because that just, like, in my experience, the people who were beside me listening to Weezer were other Black kids.
Yes. That's both unique in the kinds of testimonials that that often get favored in terms of thinking about, you know, Black cultural life worlds and who inhabit them. But it is also, it's generationally unique. I was a part of that. I sound long in the tooth, back in my day kind of thing. But I was sort of the younger end of the Black Rock Coalition era, and, you know, came of age in college loving Living Color. And I used to fight about it, the band, not the TV show. I have issues with the Wayans, even though the Wayans did some important things. But I also, as children of Prince, there was a kind of little subculture within the subculture of Black folks and that's not the word I want to use, but I'm going to go with it right now, but bohemian white school age, you know, allies. Oh, somebody charged complicated words I'd like to take apart here. That kind of, you know, we saw ourselves as a populating the universe of the Purple Rain finale, you know, and that was our sort of utopian way of thinking about, you know, alternative Blackness, also charged, we should take that apart. But we still understood ourselves to be a subculture as opposed to a part of the ecosystem that you're describing. And that gives me hope, actually.
Yeah.
I'd love to think of that, you know?
Yeah. Gosh, it's, I mean, and I guess I never answered the question about having an old magazine collection, but I do think a part of this is just because I grew up in an era of magazines. You know, my older brother got Source magazine and XXL and just stashed them all. And so I grew up in a house, and my parents got Jet to the house my yes. entire life, you know, and they were always present, you know. It was like the Jet magazines were on a coffee table or in the bathroom, yes. and yep. the Source magazines were stacked in a pile in the bed. And so, you know, I grew up reading album reviews and whatnot through these sources, and I still kind of want the physical object. The day Little Richard died, instinctively, because he's on that cover, he's on the cover of Rolling Stone one time. And just instinctively, I was like, I got to go find it. I got to get it online
yes.
before,
yes.
before Same. Someone starts charging yes. millions of dollars for it, no, you know?
Our kindred, yes. No, I grew up subscribing to Rolling Stone. I mean, part of the narrative that I try to take apart and that I've talked about in a lot of different places, but how rock criticism became the interlocutor that I longed for to kind of think through the sounds that I was gravitating towards that, you know, took me, were a point of divergence from my family. And so I was kind of raised on rock criticism and also the Black feminist literature that my sister, who was going to the Great Mills College in Oakland, would bring home for me on the weekends. And I was too young to be reading all of that. And yet, you know, just the right age also. But I started subscribing to Rolling Stone with my allowance, and then would take apart, sorry to my archivist self now, but you know, I would take the covers off whenever it was a Black artist. And I wish that we had a photograph of my bedroom. My mother probably does, because she was always so worked about me cleaning up. But you know, I can name all the Black artists from my era in the 80s whenever they would appear. And after Jeff Buckley died, I wrote a 33 1/3 about him. He drowned the day that I filed my dissertation in grad school. He had been my favorite artist during this last couple of years of grad school, a few years, 95 through 97. But I wrote to Rolling Stone. I love that we're having this conversation in this context. A long letter that took a long time to write, and I was faxing it. And I wasn't sure it was getting there. So they probably received 20 copies of this letter, faxing over and over and over. And it moved through, you know, all sorts of questions about, you know, where Buckley was in their kind of critical life world, given that he was both drawn to Led Zeppelin, but also Nina Simone. But then it moved to the fact that Kevin Powell had done a cover story on Tupac after he died, and what does it mean? And I know you've written about this. Maybe this is in the book or somewhere else, but just for Black folks to, you know, be regarded through their death, you know, hagiographically with Black musicians. So I identified that. And then I also, I think the letter ended with, and Salt-N-Pepa's never been on the cover. And, you know, we have to give it up for the hip hop women pioneers. And I doubt if I had anything to do with it, but it was 6 months later that they ended up on the cover.
Yeah, I remember that. I remember them on the cover. Jeff Buckley's someone I came too late. I was actually just thinking about this. I didn't hear Grace until I was in college. I was a freshman in college and someone played it for me. I just wasn't familiar, you know, like for all my music discovery in my youth, there were just large swaths of stuff that I did not get to. And I didn't hear Grace until I was like I was a 17-year-old college freshman or just turned 18. And hearing that album for the first time is so memorable to me. Yes. And then the disappointment of finding out that there was such little, there's so little else of his like recorded work, you know,
yeah.
I think that's a memory that will always stand out to me. So this was in like the Napster era. And I remember hearing someone play the CD for me in my dorm room. And I went back to my dorm room and like downloaded Grace on Napster. And I was like, all right, what else? And found out there's like not much, there's not much else. There was some like scattered live recordings and B-sides and whatnot.
Yeah. Yeah. No, and those live recordings, Live at the Chennai, which, you know, broke him open, is so incredible. But
yeah,
you know, he's an important figure maybe for us to linger on, or that I would flag in terms of thinking about one of the affinities that I will venture to suggest that we share, which is that he was such a bold and fearless and prodigious listener. And one of the reasons why he had so little of a repertoire, recorded repertoire in part, was that he had this long, you know, standing gig at this tiny, you know, coffee house, Chennai, right in the Lower East Side. And that was his extended period of artisanship and, you know, a kind of almost graduate school, as he would sometimes refer to it, of being able to listen through and play through all of the sounds that were meaningful to him in discovering who he was as an artist. And I really, one of the things that I appreciate so much about your writing and I've now heard you talk about this a little bit in different spaces, but the invitation, the generosity of the invitation to listen along with you as you are working through, you know, an archive of sounds and cultural moments to get to some, you know, philosophical point of renovation, a crystallization of ideas, but that kind of gathering place, that commons that you create in your prose is so crucial in being able to get to that place. Let's gather together and listen and try to break open something that's beneath the surface. And it's a really beautiful and unique gift that you have as a critic to do that. So I want to thank you for that. But I also was curious to hear you talk about, you know, just how you think about transposing the event of listening into a written event.
I think that's a good question. Thank you for the kind compliment. I think it's so much because I believe in or think about listening has always been so visual for me, in part because I think I haven't been able, I mean, you know, I haven't done the brain work on this, but I would guess it's because I came up like directly in what I think is the golden era of the music video, where the kind of experimental edge of we can make music videos now had worn off. And so like post Take On Me kind of thing, which those are great videos, obviously, but the form became a little bit more democratized, I think, in the 90s. And when I say I grew up in the video, I mean, you know, I'm sure you remember this. There were points where like videos would premiere on like network television in prime time, sure. You know? Yes. So
yeah.
The music video era was in rap music videos too. I mentioned this yesterday during the talk I did, where it's like, I think from like 92 to 99, just an incredible era of rap music videos. And so what that did for me was imagining every listening experience as a visual experience, even if these songs weren't singles. Mm-hmm. Like imagining how it might be rendered in the visual world, which means that I think that I spent a lot of time getting an understanding for the seeing of sound and seeing the way sound works and what the seeing of sound could afford, which for me means that in the writing experience, I'm trying to recreate that textually. Because it's one thing to be like, this musician looks like this when they play, or this musician is wearing this outfit. Oh, that's fine, I guess. But it's another thing to say, this sounds like something you can relate to. I always think about The Chain, Fleetwood Mac's The Chain, right? Where
that is the jam.
Right. I mean, but the infamous part where everything gets stripped down and then we return with just John McVie's bass and then the drums build up and then Lindsey's guitar. And there's not that much of a space between like the introduction of Lindsey's guitar tone to the point where the guitar is like attacking over everything else. Yeah. And it sounds, I mean, that collision of sound is horrifying to me, beautiful, but it sounds like animals fighting to get out of a cage, you know? And if
which
I can enliven
that kind of was doing.
Yeah, right. No, but that's it, right? That's the whole thing. Right? It's the embodiment. Like The Chain is like that part of The Chain is the embodiment of the whole album. And there has to be a way I can get people to understand the tension and ferocity in that sonically so that they can listen to it a little differently.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's really powerful. I think it's also, it's part of at least the revolutionary tactics of Black critics that I'm, you know, trying to bring out in the book, especially Black women critics and Black musicians who operate as critics, to be able to shift our attention, shift the dominant hegemonic culture's attention to take note of and to really have to pass through the authority and desires of the Black listener and to make the Black listener, audible, visible, and affectively present. Because as you map out across different scenes in the book, we are reminded again and again of that erasure of, you know, Black folks populating cultural scenes and either being negated from having any kind of value in relation to the scenes as fans, as critics, as accomplices, right? Of all of the above, we're utilized in a way that serves purposes that, you know, are about ultimately negating us, you know, or for someone else's pleasure and enjoyment. And so, you know, this kind of work, which I see as being very much, you know, in the genealogy of our great Black culture critics, Greg Tate, Talani Davis, Danielle Smith, our contemporaries like Wesley Morris, and then folks in my world in academia, like Farah Jasmine Griffin and Brent Hayes Edwards, George Lewis, Guthrie Ramsey, I could go on and on. They're trying to do that work, you know, of shifting the lens of, you know, who gets to lay claim to listening that's valued, you know, and of meaning and currency. I don't want to quite use that word. That's a word that comes up in different ways in your book, but.
So outside of the generosity of your book and the size of it is generous, but also the way that the size is utilized, like for me, and I know that you have other volumes of this planned. I know that this isn't the end, but for me, like, despite the book's just the robust nature of it, I was still like, gosh, and despite how generously the history is approached, I was like, I can't wait until these other volumes drop because, I'm a completionist in that way. But also, I love thinking about citation, and I've been thinking about how musically what I really miss is that we're almost in a post minor notes era because of the in the music world, because of the digital nature of how we stream. And so there's like a lineage that gets lost where one can't. I mean, growing up, I was someone who just read the inside of, I mean, I still now when I get records, I just sit and read the inside of these records. Particularly with hip hop, because sampling and getting to root sounds. And so there's something I was so thrilled about with the book was the notes section, which is longer than any notes section I think I've ever come across, but it was so refreshing and exciting for me because I felt like I was back going through the liner notes of records and like sourcing my way back to things that I didn't know existed or that I had forgotten existed, or it was a beautiful way to see how the book was built. And I was wondering if you talk a bit about that process. Were you like, were you charting out these notes as you were writing, or did you get to the end of the book and you're like, oh shit, I got to go back and chart back through what I wrote and then pull all these notes out?
Yeah. I mean, it was all of the things. I think, you know, our academic training really calls for citation in sometimes rigid ways, a kind of structure of apprenticeship, a word I used earlier, especially with your first book in academia and being able to prove you understand, you know, where your work is situated and who you're in conversation with. Actually, maybe that's more of a little bit later, but, you know, being able to like prove you have that knowledge that you're then building on. And I think for me as a Black feminist critic, it really became about in this book, and I still wake up in a cold sweat like The Godfather, remembering people I left out and like the acknowledgments. I like to think of it as it comes from working a book for a decade, and, you know, I need to be better about making all the lists of everyone who helped out. But in trying to do that at all, both intellectual, scholarly, critical way through the notes, but also in the acknowledgments, it is a kind of ethical practice that I try to pass on to my students and saying, you know, we need to kind of break down the fetishization of the auteur, of the critic who knows all, who doesn't have to do the kind of case making for anybody else but themselves or a small circle of people, and to bring everyone into the conversation in order to acknowledge that we're all deeply entangled with one another in terms of the collaboration of this, you know, sometimes often terrifying event called America, you know, and likewise simultaneously exhilarating event called America. So it's a Black feminist praxis to be able to call attention to all the lateral people involved. I say to a lot of my colleagues, like, we wrote this together, and to also acknowledge my graduate students who helped out so much. And it's a kind of political, I feel like, an intellectual intervention in how criticism in certain circles has been done. But to the actual nuts and bolts of how I did it, it was a little bit improvisational, which I feel in your prose too. The footnotes would be sparked by, okay, I need to go deep now and being able to explain the history of this, you know, how we got to the moment of, you know, Aretha being in Amsterdam playing. I'm not sure if that's a deep note or not, but yeah, that's the kind of example that I would give. Or, you know, Lorraine Hansberry, we could talk about this one document, you know, on her desk that she held precious to her. But now let's go into the notes and talk about all of the other, you know, contextual documents that were in conversation with this one object. But I feel that, you know, at the top of your prose as well, that there's something structurally, you know, serialized in terms of how you are taking your reader on a journey through all of these concatenate, you know, cultural moments that amount to you being in this place. You know, Hanif from Ohio receives all of this, but we have to go through Joe Baker, you know, and back, you know, yeah, across oceans and mountains. And it's very big. And that's the bigness of Black culture and Black cultural life that's captured in your work.
I've been thinking a lot about, so I finished this last night and made a bunch of marks in it, which I'm not usually a marker in books, not because I'm precious about books, but because it makes it hard for me to return to them when I'm like, the pages are all marked up. But I've been thinking about just, you know, I grew up reading because of the magazines I was reading, because of how I was spending time. I grew up reading a lot of Black women critics because by virtue of growing up in a Black home that where like Ebony and Source and Jet were the magazines. And of course knew that like music criticism had been, or the gatekeeping nature of music criticism had been largely held by men and particularly white men. But it felt like there was, and I've been thinking about this other thing about how Black feminist critique is, I don't know word this well, but I think it's perhaps something I understood outside the confines of written language. Mm-hmm. You know, to grow up in a house with a mother and a grandmother, and to grow up in a neighborhood with many Black mothers, and to see how they assess the world and how they assess their love for their children through their lenses and what wasn't allowed and what was allowed. There's something that I think I understood about Black feminist critique even before fully absorbing Black feminist writers, or knowing that the writers I was absorbing were Black feminist writers. You know what I mean? Before I even knew, like, before I had a full, you know, at 12 years old, I'm not entirely sure. I'm not going to give myself the credit of being entirely sure what Black feminism was as a practice, right? But understanding now, looking back, that it lived in many ways. And I think about the like multitudinous approach to this book. And I want to talk about the A-sides and the B-side too, but largely I was wondering how you assessed and thought through the wide breadth of the way those critiques live in the world when working on this, which is, of course, largely about sound and music, but I think it's also about so much more.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, thank you. I mean, Toni Morrison, who I have brought here because this book, Jazz.
That is the best one. That's my favorite one.
It's my jam. It is my jam. And I was thinking about it quite a bit when I was reading your book, but I look to her work in order to try to think through the kinds of the exigencies of Black life that we're now, you know, talking about in common spaces and the public imaginary, but that her generation of Black feminist scholars really bequeathed to us these questions about the broader stakes of what it means to build our own life worlds. I mean, she does that structurally with her novels. She talks about how, you know, her first sentences, her first paragraphs are about orienting you in a Black world. You are stepping into a Black world and you need to kind of to recalibrate if you are outside of that world, how you manage and perceive of the universe, right? And, you know, that's a kind of, and that's also very much at work in your book. And it's a kind of, you know, a radical way of defining quotidian freedom politics through a reclamation of one's own the value of one's own vantage point, right? Being able to see and feel and hear yourself. That's a Black feminist endeavor in terms of how it is valued and championed and defended, which is not to say that we didn't have, you know, over a century's worth of extraordinary writing and thinking by Black freedom fighters from Frederick Douglass to Du Bois and on, but that the Black feminist politics of that meant in the 70s that, and the Combahee River collective statement from 77, which was such a breakthrough in so many ways, really defines like what it means to be able to actually think from the vantage point of and care about the life worlds and conditions of Black women means that we're all free. If we think about women of color being at the bottom of the chains and chains of subjugation. So that's a that's an ethic that, you know, is coursing through my work and all Black feminist work, but it's also the ways that that kind of, you know, the actual architecture of the book is operating, which is not to say that, as some of my Black feminist colleagues and women of color colleagues have put it, it's not to say that there aren't villains in this book, many of whom are critics who have trouble imagining that kind of, you know, epistemological shift, right? To actually think along a different axis of you know, how the world is experienced by others. And so they are a part of the narrative, but they can't dominate the narrative. And that's a Toni Morrison, you know, lesson if ever there was one.
Of course.
To answer your question. You know, I was the reason why I was thinking about Jess so much, not only because shared, you know, favorite of Professor Morrison's, who, by the way, she was my colleague at Princeton, which is absolutely insane. So I did have the deep honor. Yes. You know, I had met her as an undergrad at Berkeley, which shout out to UC Berkeley, which it was a family school when my parents migrated from Texarkana and Texarkana, Texas, and Arkansas, Hope, Arkansas, Genoa, Arkansas, Texarkana, Arkansas. But my dad went to grad school at Berkeley in the 50s. And so it was a part of the great migration mythology and hope of our family. But for me, once I started reading Rolling Stone, I was like, oh, Jan Winter went there. Grail Marcus went there. Oh, hell yeah. So yeah. That's the weird ass sister that I am. But Toni's son Ford was at Berkeley when I was an undergrad, and she was in residence when Beloved came out. So we got to hear her read Beloved the week it came out. I mean, just everything.
Wow.
And then I became her colleague many years later. I mean, I could do lots of sidebars, like how she when she retired, there was a big party that was at Lincoln Center, but she used to have parties at her house and invite, you know, and see Fran Lebowitz and Sonia Sanchez. It's just absolutely insane. But she also would occasionally come back and teach classes. And one semester, she taught a class that was in the room right before me. And Felicia Rashad, who was performing in Gem of the Ocean at MacArthur Theater that semester, was auditing the class. And so I would walk in and there's Felicia Rashad and Toni Morrison, and they would usually give a comment about what I was wearing, always really kind, want to know about the colors. It was just mind-boggling. So that's my little Toni Morrison anecdote.
She's, you know, she means a lot to me, as, you know, I stress always. In
Ohio.
She's great, one of the great Ohio writers. I mean, I think, for me, the greatest Ohio writer. And as a small aside, I mean, another of my favorite Ohio writers, Tracy Chapman, who I think people don't think about as a great writer, but I think she's like a better fiction writer than almost anyone, you know?
Yeah, no, she's incredible. She's kind of like the epitome of living a life deep in the cut, you know, in a way that is like really powerful. So yeah, let's hear it for Ohio. My God, the site that runs through so much of Morrison's work. I'm teaching the seminar on Toni Morrison again. So it's wonderful. And we're teaching jazz. I'm teaching jazz. I'm co-teaching jazz next week with my two graduate students, my wonderful graduate students, Jocelyn Peretti and Jazz Riley. But there's my favorite passage in jazz, which comes towards the end. I just want to read a little bit of it because it stood out for me with regards to how you are writing about Black performance. So, and this is the mysterious narrator. So I missed it altogether. I was sure one would kill the other. I waited for it so I could describe it. I was so sure it would happen, that the past was an abused record with no choice but to repeat itself at the crack, and no power on earth could lift the arm that held the needle. I was so sure, and they danced and walked all over me. Busy they were, busy being original, complicated, changeable, human, I guess you'd say, while I was the predictable one, confused in my solitude and arrogance, thinking my space, my view was the only one that was or that mattered. I just come back to this moment, you know, the idea of being busy, being original, complicated, changeable, human. I mean, encapsulates so much of what you capture in your book. So I'm just wondering about how you think about that. And I guess, you know, when so many of us teach jazz, we talk about improvisation. And I felt like that is kind of, it's a through line in the book as well, although it's not a word that you use. And so I'm kind of curious about that as well.
It's funny. I mean, Jazz is my favorite book by Toni Morrison, and Jazz is a book that I had whenever I'm working on a book, and some of them are still here on my desk. I have like a stack of books on my desk that I kind of pull when I'm stuck and just read out of. And I have a few now, but it's funny because in some ways I was writing about people who have historical gaps in the miracles they performed. And so I had to improvise a story in the center of those gaps. It's what I've been calling the Ellen Armstrong dilemma, because there's a chapter in the book about magical Negroes and it ends with the bit about Ellen Armstrong. And Ellen Armstrong is someone, a rabbit hole I fell down, because when the phrase Black Girl Magic was getting commodified, whenever that happened, there was an essay that came out that was a little incendiary and maybe took the term too literally, where it was like, well, Black women aren't literally magicians or whatever. And I was like, in as people were deriding that essay, I was like, but I bet there was. I mean, there certainly have been. And so like, let me get to the root of, and that wasn't even me. I'm thankful for that essay because it made my brain spark to like, well, I wonder who the first Black woman magician on record was. And I found Ellen Armstrong, but there is so little about Ellen Armstrong that you can access. And I was cold calling magic historians and just asking, like, can you tell me anything about this woman? Like, I can only access so little online. And this woman was performing miraculous work. I mean, outside of the realm of capital M magic, she was also providing Black folks with miracles in a time when miracles were at a premium. And there's so little on her life that I had to not invent a story about her life, but I had to invent meaning to fill in those gaps and had to project that meaning. And so there was so much improvisation in that way because I think, you know, we were talking about Fela Kuti. I mean, if Ellen Armstrong were even a man, let alone a white man, right, the record would be more robust on her living. And I ran into that in the book, even with people like Josephine Baker, who, because I wrote a bit about Josephine Baker's like later life, and the record on her later life is so under cared for. And so there's improvisation because there's not access to the fullness of a person's being, which is, you know, I am someone who, I'm certainly not a Josephine Baker historian, but I love Josephine Baker so much and have read and researched Josephine Baker so much. And it took me so long to find out that she spoke at the March on Washington to get to that point, because there's just not a strong record of it. In the March on Washington has been so male-centered. Yes. And so like cherry-picked, even with its male-centered historical lens, it's still been cherry-picked, right? Yes. And Josephine Baker gets left out of both of those things. And so I ran into those problems a lot, not just with the women I wrote about in the book, but also, you know, but more primarily with women, but also with folks like Sandman Sims at the Apollo. Bea Ford was the big one, where like the role that she played as like almost an accessory in the Joe Tex James Brown feud, but there's like so little other record of her living.
Yeah, this is the jam. This is one of my career-long obsessions, is with historical and archival opacities, the fancy way that we talk about it in the academy, right? But just you know, what we have access to in terms of the historical record. You know, two things I want to say about that. To start with the opacities, I mean, a large part of what I'm trying to do in the second half of the book, which is divided into side A and side B, is to call attention to the ways that the historical record as it relates to Black music has been so wholly dominated by white writers, white narrative, white affective relations to Black music and what they cared for and valued and devalued, that it means that we have a kind of a particular kind of mediation of how we come to understand, you know, the meaning, the value, the impact and evolution of Black women's musicianship across the 20th and even some might argue into the 21st centuries. And so the kind of experimentation that I'm, you know, trying to dig into is to think in a speculative way, just as you're describing, about the things that are lost to us, you know, in the historical record, because nobody cared about them. Nobody cared about the fact that my mother growing up in Jim Crow, Texas, you know, as an African-American teenager, loved with her girlfriends going to the record shop and, you know, would jam to Billy Eckstein in the listening booths. And so on the one hand, I thank God I can interview her about this. But, you know, what is the broader kind of panoramic landscape in which, you know, Black girls, Black women fans had attachment to Black sounds, but didn't have the kind of, you know, public recourse to actually express and articulate all of their feelings and desires that were archived in the music. So I wanted to be able to capture that. And there's a lot of work from Morrison and Beloved to the great Black feminist critic and scholar Sadia Hartman and her mammoth work in which she talks about this idea of critical fabulation, like what it means to critically, you know, become a fabulist and to actually take hold of these different kinds of scenarios that we don't have documentation for, but that are felt and that move through oral history and through our kinds of adjacencies to other people in our families and our communities. Now, the other thing about that I'll say is that some of the usual suspects, there's a guy I won't name who went on the social medias a little while ago last month and said about the piece that I wrote, which was kind of an excerpt of the book in the New York Times last summer about Black women and girl fans in relation to Mamie Smith's Crazy Blues, first recording of the blues by an African-American. He said, how does Daphne Brooks know that Black women and girls were listening to this record? I need evidence. I need data. I need statistics. And I said, you know, fill in the blank. I said this actually to other people because don't want to give up my labor too much, but I said, you know, this book wasn't written for him, but it's all about him, to rephrase, a kind of redo a Carly Simon, you know? So, but it's an interesting thing because, you know, calling attention to the structures of power that have limited Black folks' access to that history is a part of the reasons why the music and these performances exist in the first place, right? And what I've tried to ask of the critics, some of the villains, is, you know, what would happen if you had to write through that history as you're talking about, you know, these sounds that you feel so close to, so attached to? What would it mean for you to actually take yourself as an object of inquiry and as a part of the story of the music, right? And to make yourself visible because you're there, you're all over the way that you're writing. But I digress.
I think that would require a relationship, an actual relationship that honors the humanity of the music makers. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Which I think, you know, and I, let me be clear, I love the album Graceland a lot. But one thing that always strikes me about Graceland is that in interviews, Paul Simon would say stuff like, well, I don't think this is a political record. I don't know why people think this is a political record. And it's like, man, the musicians can't, like, you are operating in a studio where the musicians can't fucking, like, come to at certain times, this, you know, like the musicians have to, like, right, leave the studio, right, to get home before dark. Like, what do you mean you're not making, you're, right, making a political, yeah, record by virtue of the fact that you're recording in, yeah, South Africa during apartheid, you know? Yes. But I think that's a disconnect that shows up in the white critical imagination too. For, I went down a Sly Stone rabbit hole on his birthday couple weeks ago, March 15th. And yeah. And like reading about reading like older views of There's a Riot Going On, it, you can tell that like white critics are approaching the political nuances of the record, but then would rather talk about the oddity of how it was constructed or, you know, the kind of frantic sonic nature of it. And all that shit acts as a shield, right? Because it allows one to detach and divorce themselves from the real life implications and narratives of how Black folks are living.
Yes.
And just reducing
it. How Black music was made. Why? And how Black music was made.
Yeah.
Right.
And like, you know? like music exists under a set of circumstances. You know what I mean? Yes. Like there are circular circumstances that lead to the type of conditions under which music is made. And to ignore that and strictly talk about songs just doesn't make any sense to me.
Right. Right. I mean, and that's what I mean by Black study in my book. And there are some people who have presumed that I am talking about institutional Black studies, which is about a half a century old within the university culture and is terrific. I mean, I'm housed within it. It's crucial for a variety of reasons, but Black study exceeds the institution of Black studies by a few hundred years, right? And, you know, in terms of the published world, we could maybe link it to Phyllis Wheatley, you know, but we're talking about, you know, a kind of the quotidian practices in which Black life is regarded as a thing to be, you know, interrogated, engaged with, and, you know, reckoned with in the context of a long history. That is, you know, grassroots Black study. And what I fear sometimes is that the kind of misinterpretation of, you know, the formulation that I'm using will allow people to feel that they don't have to do the work, right? So like, well, I didn't study Black studies and I shouldn't have to. And I'm like, but you know, Black study is kind of it's the study of American life. And, you know, we all participate in that. And some of us fail at it, you know, in spectacular ways, but we are all caught up in it, right? I want to talk about magic. Can we talk about first of all, Ellen, oh my God. So Ellen Armstrong, I did not know about, blew my mind in terms of university culture and Black studies. My first academic book called Bodies in Descent has a chapter about Henry Box Brown, the brother who mailed himself out of slavery and then mailed himself again in the UK, which was, you know, coterminous with Houdini, and mounted a moving panorama show across the UK or in different parts of the UK, but also for the Fugitive Slave Act in 1850. He had originally mounted it in New England. But this is where I feel like improvisation again is, it's a powerful theme in your book. And it reminded me, obviously, it came with all the props, but I got a text the other day from one of my superhero genius thinkers, literally a MacArthur genius, Jason Moran, the great jazz musician. And for whatever reason, Jason was reading my Henry Box Brown chapter, but I want to take you to this musical place that we get to, but he starts with showing me, like, you probably can't see this, but he highlighted this part of the page where he says, this is me, that he highlighted, perhaps Brown, Henry Box Brown, recognized, like Houdini, that his life was tolerable only if he could assure himself time after time that he could defeat death. That's a citation, that he could defeat the peculiar institution, that's me, at its own game of transforming people into things, which to me felt, again, very much like what you return to again and again and again in this book, Hanif. And then Jason says, and I did ask him permission, to somehow reading this makes me think of Coltrane's epic solos, 28 minutes of hard blowing resurrection, right? And then he continues, there was something about the way you wrote about the box. It felt like a long improvisation, dropping gem after gem. But then that sentence fucked me up. It is what I call a window in an improvisation when a new possibility is revealed unto the music, when a new possibility is revealed in the music, but the band will have to determine if they want to stay in the course or all leap out the window. All that to say, there is so much I learned this morning from you and Henry. Again, this feels like a crystallization of A Little Devil in America, right? Yeah. Just the windows, right? The windows that you build for us in this book. So I'm interested in and hearing how you think about windows in your prose.
I love magic. I mean, my last poetry book, which was the last book before Little Devil, was kind of framed around the Prestige, the film, yes, and the book, but more so the film. And I went down this obsession, this rabbit hole obsession with magicians and magic and the trick of widening my belief and my perspectives of what I believe I and think that I saw and or heard, and allow myself real comfort with being wrong about that. And in doing so, writing in a way that kind of puts my arm around a reader and says, isn't it more fun if we're just uncertain and we go on this journey together? Yes. That feels like a type of magic trick too, right? Where it's like coming to the work with uncertainty and stumbling towards something that might not be certainty, but might be better than where we started. And I think in doing so, you know, so much of my writing in real time is me trying to figure something out, going through a lot of, that's why I write in sections so often, because to conclude a section doesn't mean I'm concluding the fullness of an idea. It means I am, if we're going to talk about windows, it means I'm prying open one window as far as I can and then trying to get out of it. And when that doesn't work, I'm building another window.
Yes. You know? Yes. Yeah.
And that's kind of the trick of the writing for me.
I love that. And one of my dear interlocutors, like mammoth, giant thinker of Latinx feminist sounds, Alexandra Vasquez, mm-hmm, wrote a book called Listening in Detail.
Yeah.
She's also written quite a bit about, you know, the ways that you destabilize a kind of arrogance in music writing around knowing, right? So she actually has a piece called On Not Knowing, right? I think this came up in the conversation last night where I was held hostage in a faculty meeting, so I only heard a fragment of it. But the ways that you know, that the different dimensions of generosity in your writing extend to the kind of space of being together and not knowing and having to improvise, right? And experiment with and rehearse a variety of different possibilities. I mean, and that's a Black radical tradition, Freedom Project, if ever there was one. And it's very beautiful and exhilarating. It also involves trust, which is another big trope in this book that I'm sure you've been talking about quite a bit. And that leads me at least to thinking alongside you about being a Black person with all sorts of questions and about dancing, having grown up in Menlo Park, California, and Palo Alto, California, and my godbrother Dave Swerdlick, who works on CNN now and at the Washington Post, but back when we were undergrads at Berkeley, he took me aside his freshman year, I was a sophomore, and he said, "Look, we need to figure out how to do this because this is about stone cold survival." Right? I'm like, okay, man.
Yes, indeed.
All right.
Yeah.
And so that trope of trust is so powerful in this book. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about that as a writer, about trust and also not knowing.
Yeah, I mean, part of this, and I'm going to throw a question back at you, but part of this is because I don't have the same background a lot of writers have. You know, I just don't. So I came to writing differently. You know, I didn't study it in college. I was not a good student at any level of my schooling. I, you know, learned how to write through like writing for punk zines and coming up and thinking about writing purely as a tool of information delivery and making information delivery as exciting as possible. And also as a tool to widen my social ability to talk about the things I'm excited about, which is where trust comes in. You know, I came up, there are critics I grew up reading and loving, you know, Lester Bangs and Greil Marcus among them. I mean, Greil's book, the Greil's Mystery Train book is on my desk right now.
My guys. You know,
and Greil is someone I love a great deal. But these critics, like white critics I grew up reading, would talk to me as though I'd loved The Clash my whole life, even if I'd never heard them. You know, they would talk to me as though, you know, Greil was writing about the band as though I'd loved the band my whole life. And I don't know if this is, and that's not disparaging them. It's saying that maybe they unlock something in me that's like, oh, if I'm going to write about the Migos, I'm going to write about them as though people have heard them their whole lives. If I'm going to write about spades in my book, I'm not going to explain the game of spades. Why would I do that when I could spend a little more time ruminating on the miracle of playing spades? And what that does for me in terms of trust is, and in terms of understanding that I don't know everything is understanding that I came up not knowing shit. And the real pleasure that I had was in the seeking.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You know, like Real Marcus led me to the band.
Yeah.
And what a pleasure it was to get music from Big Pink from the library. Yeah. And to hear like Tears of Rage for the first time, you know, like to hear that album, like open with that song and be like, oh, this is it. This is definitely a band of love. You know, like I can't explain the feeling of hearing like Richard Manuel's voice for the first time and being like, oh, wow. Like this is, and I don't want to take that excitement from anyone. You know, I want people to come to spades the way I came to spades, like sitting at a table and get my ass kicked and getting clowned, you know? And finding affection through that. And so because I know I don't know anything, I know the real pleasure in finding, in seeking. Yeah. And I don't want to cheat anyone of that experience. Yeah. And I think there's a trust in that too, you know?
Oh man, that's so beautiful. I mean, you've helped me to find my way towards expanding the response that I gave to the great Brent Edwards, who wrote Epistrophes, Jazz, and the Literary Imagination, one of our greatest jazz study scholars of all time. But Brent asked me in an event for the Schomburg Library, the historic Schomburg Library, the other night. He said, you know, I get why the critics, the rock critics, the blues critics that you know, are dissecting this book need to be reading us, and it means very broadly, like Black thinkers of all kinds, in trying to more ecumenically and more imaginatively handle and care for Black music. I get that, but why should we read rock criticism, right? This is the question that he asked me. He's like, you know, I'm still hanging out with that, you know, your suggestion. And I was saying to him, you know, from my standpoint, reading Rolling Stone and Cream when I was coming up was just the counterpoint to if my sister's bringing home The Bluest Eye, and again, way too young to read The Color Purple, Tar Baby for Colored Girls. And those books are the testimonial that we needed in order to re-inhabit our bodies as Black women. There was something I was drawn to about that writing that was not only about, okay, this will tell me why I love Stuart Copeland as a drummer so much, but there's something about the form and the voice. Some of it is ugly and masculinist, and I don't want any of that. But some of it is about kind of starting from a point of affirming one's own pleasure, right? And the validity of one's own life world, like you were just describing, that we should be able to claim, right? As Black thinkers, as Black people. And you know, being able to fuse those two thinking worlds and creative worlds together is really the energy of the book that I'm trying to push forward. And it's very much alive in your work. It's so alive, you know, it's a beautiful thing.
Can I circle back and ask a question about the form of the book? Because what I like about the A side and B side format is that the B side is, it does feel to me like a record where the B-side is a little bit more free and I think riskier in form. Yeah, and I'm sure that was intentional, obviously, but when was that decision made? And when you were writing the B-side, did you know it was the B-side, or was it just like, oh, this is definitely a side B as you were going?
Right. Yeah, no, thanks for that question. And this is like big citation time again. So I worked with a creative editor named Nathan Young in Wisconsin. Weirdly, I mean, he's in Milwaukee, not far from Grafton, Wisconsin, where Paramount Records was, where, you know, a certain portion of the book is focused on that place in the early 1930s. But Nate came into my life in 2019 when the book was, believe it or not, even longer than this. And we were trying to streamline it. And he said to me, you know, I just feel like there are so many different kinds of voices that you have in this book, which is great. But I also think that that's part of the project too. And he was the one who said, because I had divided it into part one and part two, and there was a part three about the sisters of Porgy and Bess that's going to be its own standalone book now, and about anti-Blackness in Porgy and Bess, which always lights up white people. But, you know, once we lopped that off, then, you know, we were thinking about the two parts. And he said, side A and side B, because you really are, especially by the second half of the book, you're really paying attention to, I think I said this in conversation with him, but paying attention to the ways that the records themselves have all of these histories stored up in them that begin with the material condition of the record itself. So for instance, I'm thinking a great deal about the scratches on those old 78s and who owned them first, who loved them first. But he was kind of the person who got me to think structurally about it. And then, I mean, things just were happening over time because this book, again, took so long to write. But when Sadia Hartman's, you know, history-making, path-breaking book, Wayward Lives, Beautiful Experiments came out, I was asked to be a part of a salon at Barnard University with a number of just incredible scholars where we were responding to the book. It was like the weekend it came out or the weekend before it came out. And that's when I wrote most of what became the preface to Side B. And it was a kind of writing that was in tune with how I had been writing about music for some time, but I was trying to do it with a book. And that came from an exercise, citation again, really a writing assignment that I've talked about a lot in recent weeks in relation to the book, called Critical Karaoke, which the poet and scholar, Josh Clover. Joshua Clover wrote in 1989. And Josh Clover, great music critic, in 2004, convened this session that he called Critical Karaoke for this conference that has now been in existence almost 2 decades. I don't know if you've ever come there, Hanif. Experience Music Project Museum Conference in Seattle. Is the museum created by the late Paul Allen of Microsoft, who loved Jimi Hendrix. But there was a conference that started in 2002, co-led by Eric Weisbart and Ann Powers. The popular book series that you were speaking at last night kind of came out of that. It's now called the Museum of Pop Culture, but every year in the spring, we come together and, you know, share our work, and it's a deeply experimental place. And Josh said, you know, he pulled a bunch of us together. It was Greil and Powers, me, Oliver Wang. I'm sure I'm going to forget someone. He said, pick a song at some point in your life. You had a passionate attachment to, you know, love it, hate it, whatever. Write about it, critical, autobiographical. The catch is when you present your piece, it has to be the length, exact length of the song, which was like the greatest exercise ever. Yeah. Really, it's the greatest exercise ever.
Yeah.
And it transformed everybody's writing. I mean, there is a kind of paper now that we think of as coming out of EMP. And it's certainly how I kind of ethically continued writing about music, writing alongside the music, writing close to it, combining autobiographical and different kinds of critical and historical takes on the music. And then it kind of carried into my scholarly writing in another way, to be able to write about Sadia's book, you know, as like a deep cut and writing close to it. And so the beginning of Side B is literally, that's the same, it's the same piece, but it's a long way of saying that it kind of came together over time. But there was a moment where, especially when that long set of conversations I was having with John Jeremiah Sullivan and Greil Marcus about Gishy and Alvey, the Gishy and Alvey recordings were unfolding, that I knew that that was its own thing. And there were people even said, oh, that should just be a little book on its own. I said, no. It's a part of the story that I'm trying to tell about these Black women musicians and thinkers who are trying to, you know, value and revalue their own work. I mean, they're a part of this too. So we have to all be together in the arena, so to speak.
I think about this now that I'm a person who creates things that people seem to want. And so I get the question of like, when's the next thing? When's the next thing? Now it's like, I hope to never ask anyone that anymore. But because I know that you have other volumes of this that you are kind of chipping away at, I'm not going to ask when, but I'm going to ask like how they are coming.
Oh, well, that is a very kind question. Thank you for asking that. What's ahead of me right now is going back to all that Porgy and Bess material most immediately. And it's been a passion project of mine. It was supposed to have been the end of this book because it's almost a century's worth of moments in Black performance history in which Black women are operating as archives, which is one of the obsessions in this book. But archives in which they're wrestling with, you know, anti-blackness, which is the Gershwin and Hayward archive for Porgy and Bess, their own kind of negation of their personhood through the caricature of Bess, and renovating, as Maida Jones would call it, you know, re-inhabiting and subverting that script through all sorts of virtuosic sonic performances, virtuosity being another key theme in your book that I had been excited to talk with you about. Maybe we'll get to that, Josephine, very quickly. So that's a book very near and dear to my heart. And that ends with thinking about the, again, nearly centuries worth of covers of Summertime. The last time I checked, the most covered recorded song of all time. And the many different sisters, starting with the original Bess Ann Brown, but moving through Whitney, someone who's a shared focus of attention for the both of us, to, you know, Jill Scott and Angelique Kidjo, and of course Fantasia on American Idol. But, you know, in the mid-century, you couldn't be a Black performer and not do some version of Porgy and Bess. And there was a lot of energy around the train wreck Otto Preminger film. But what was happening in the recording studio with Sarah Vaughan and Lena Horne and Ella is just remarkable in terms of how they were wrestling with Gershwin. So that's a big obsession of mine, that book. The books that relate to the arc of liner notes, there's a book that right now is loosely called Nobody or a Nation, and that's coming from the Derek Walcott epic circa Atlantic poem, right? About colonialism and so many other things, but it's thinking about the terms of what some people call Afro-cosmopolitanism, but really the geopolitical stakes of Black women musicians at mid-century, who became global icons from Eartha, you know, and Josephine's in there a little bit, to Nina and the Supremes. But it's also thinking about U.S. citizenship and battling through it by way of especially early R&B and folks like Etta James. And Aretha threads through it from her Columbia years through Live at the Fillmore West, which is my favorite performance of hers of all time. And thinking about sonic citizenship as it's improvised and practiced by these women. The last one, working title, cribbed from a crib. So it's called All That You Can't Leave Behind. And originally that was a piece I wrote many years ago about Katrina in relation to Beyonce and Mary J. Blige, but it's thinking about the third reconstruction, as we may or may not call it, whatever this thing is that we've moved through and that we're post in. And the Black women musicians, particularly the Knowles sisters, as they navigate the politics of Black social life in the last portion of the 20th century through the 21st century. So short books, clearly.
Right. Yeah. I'm sure there'll be pamphlets.
Yeah, exactly. Last night at one of the events that I watched you at, you talked about how extraordinary it is to have this long and deep archive through YouTube of being able to, you know, see and hear Josephine Baker. And then, you know, one of the great moves in the book is to take us to these other points in Josephine Baker's career that we don't often think about, and also how her iconicity has permeated literally the landscapes of, you know, different spaces. So I think what I wanted to ask you about is, what is the performance of Josephine Baker's for you? And you write about this in the book, that made you most feel like you wanted to dedicate the book to her?
You know, I'm someone who's from a place, and I love the place I'm from. I live there. I live in Columbus. I'm probably never going to leave here. But I also know that it's complicated to be Black in America and have a sense of pride about being from anywhere, you know, on a large scale. Perhaps not being from, you know, like, I'm less proud to be from Columbus broadly and more proud to be from like the east side of Columbus, my block that I came up on. That's a bit more tangible. That's a pride that I can manage a bit better. But for Josephine Baker, you know, she got out. It was untenable for her to be here in the States broadly. And I think there's something interesting about her return being cloaked in a kind of somber nature, to return with the fury of realizing how slow the American machine works towards any kind of progress. You know, she'd been gone for so long, she came back, everything was kind of the same. And her March on Washington speech is so interesting to me because it's not very long, like time-wise, but it is all at once somber, it's funny, it's angry, it's triumphant, but more than that, it's a woman who is not old. I do want to, you know, she's only 57, so that's not old, but for as long as she had been performing, right, she was kind of at past the middle point of her arc as a performer. I wouldn't even say she was in the late stages of her arc as a performer, because she wasn't. You know, I imagine Josephine Baker, had she lived longer, would have been on a stage until the end, but she was kind of past what people viewed as her quote unquote prime years as a performer. And she was reflecting on that in a way that was kind of, you know, the reason I the title comes from that speech where she's looking on the younger audience and telling them to ask their grandparents about her. And, you know, your grandparents will tell you that I was a devil, and they're right. I was a devil in America, or I was a devil in other countries, and I was a little devil in America too. And there's something about that part where it's someone, much like in the spirit of what we saw Little Richard do for most of his life, much like in the spirit of Bernie Mac on stage at Def Comedy Jam, it's someone reminding you who they are and who they have been, and that they're still who they are, right?
Yes.
And that, I think, runs through the book, because so much of the legacy of Black performers is reminding people what they're capable of. There's this part I love in Amazing Grace, of the Aretha film, during How I Got Over, where like the choir like jumps into their part and they swell to a level that I think Aretha maybe is not expecting. She kind of like looks back, like she's a little startled, but she immediately snaps back to herself and goes, okay, so we're doing this now.
Right.
You know what I mean? Where it's like,
yes,
you know, she, and then the film is different. I'm not saying that before that it was bad, but you can tell she was kind of like stumbling through warm-ups and getting ready. And then that part hits and she's like, okay, so this is what we're doing. And there's something about that I love about tenured, especially like tenured Black performers who have done it for a while, is that there's a level of grace to their work so often, but they're not going to let anyone tell them they're not who they are, you know? Yes. And Josephine Baker was so late career, Josephine Baker, you know, those performances in the 70s when she's in Paris and she's like, she can't move as well, but she's still, her ability to control the crowd is still unparalleled because she can tell a crowd what she needs and they'll provide it. I'm so much more fascinated by Josephine Baker's later performances than I am by the feats of athleticism and brilliance that permeated her earlier performances, as stunning as those are. I'm so much more fascinated about performances where she's kind of like weighed down by a ton of feathers and not moving a ton, but still getting the audience to do whatever she needs them to do.
Yes, it's beautiful. It's a reminder of the ways that the audience is always a part of the stories that we're telling. And whether we're in the audience, right, or we're the performers, you know, as Black cultural thinkers, that being able to capture that wide scene, right, that wide event, you know, that's a powerful thing, and it's a necessary thing to be able to widen the lens and to experience the world on terms in which the bigness and the magnitude of Blackness can inhabit the earth. I feel that in your work. I'm so grateful for it. This is an exciting moment.
Yeah.
Keep it going.
I hope we can do this again sometime, truly, because I feel like just like getting to the heart of this book, I spent so much time just in the notes themselves, making notes for myself. It felt like I felt like I was young again. It felt like I was, you know, back when I used to look at liner notes, I used to like circle the samples and then go find the records. And I felt like I was doing that again. That was such a refreshing thing for me.
That's the critical work, though, that I love that so much. That means so much to me. It's also something that, from Talani Davis to Linnell George, another great, you know, path-breaking cultural critic, music critic, I mean, these are people who have stories of following their own critical, intellectual, cultural pursuits. And they're stories that don't get told as often as they should be, but if you felt young again, imagine how I felt reading this. Come on. This is the book that I needed when I was in Menlo Park, California, all those years ago, which I wish I could have found in the Tower Records bookshop. This has been fantastic. And I do really hope that we can do it again.
Absolutely. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Congratulations.